Welcome to the video, everyone. I have to say that the foreshadowing of problems with this comet continues in spite of my not paying attention, trying not to give it any attention at all. It continues. So, rather alarming, to say the least, which just puts the pressure on us even more for breakthroughs. I had some breakthroughs. I've had they continue. Last night, I actually saw myself in the future. I saw someone in a locale. I looked, I said, oh my gosh, that's me in the future. But that's the ego's version of me. I realize that's how the ego sees me in the future. There's a timeline. If I go with the ego, that is how I'm going to be. Really amazing. I didn't like it at all. It was very bad. It's kind of a first to see, you know, to see oneself in the future. This is how I'm going to be in the future. I was old, you know, and it's just like, whoa. Not good at all. So I also saw some personality qualities that I hadn't seen before. I just viewed them. Very bad qualities in the personality, as it were. But I looked and I said, huh, how does the ego leverage that? You see, our personalities are a result of the ego leveraging our fear of the continuity issue. The only problem we have is a continuity issue. And yet that problem is so gigantic that the ego uses it as leverage over us, to leverage us into anything it wants us to do. I also realized that the so-called negative is actually simply us expressing our disdain and dislike of this whole training program we have of trying to train ourselves how to die. It's just, and those who pretend to be all innocent and pure and kind and helpful and righteous and sweet, etc., that is really the darkness, because it's the highest type of arrogance. Those who claim they're peaceful is the highest type of arrogance, very highest. And the negative has this disdain against that, the one desire to tear them down, to expose, look, they're phonies. So you have the light that is darkness in this world, of people pretending to be happy with this training program. In other words, I feel so peaceful with this training program. I feel so sweet and kind and so innocent. I'm so pure and innocent with this training program. It is total hypocrisy, complete arrogance. And the negative ones are all fuming about that, saying, you know, you we hate this training program. You're trying to make it seem good. You're trying to market it, pass it off as something wonderful. So the negative people are actually, they hate the hypocrisy, but it doesn't solve the continuity problem. See, that is the trouble. Battling against something in this world is futile. It doesn't solve the continuity problem at all. So you're still stuck exactly where you were when you started out. That's what you'll find out. No matter what you're battling for, you will be in the same place. You'll be just spinning your wheels, getting nowhere. You have to see that the Holy Spirit is the solution to the continuity problem. And getting acquainted with the Holy Spirit and seeing, perceiving definition, the way the Holy Spirit perceives definition, is the way to resolve the continuity problem. But I've always gravitated more towards negative people, actually. Those who are kind of have a very critical, negative attitude towards the world, and people who are pretending to be so high and mighty in the world, etc., and say, oh, isn't it wonderful? And you know, remember, Jesus said he came to save the sinners. He associated with people that the Pharisees just said, you know, this guy's terrible. Look who he's associating with. Bad people. Negative, bad people, you know, those people at least are saying, my God, I hate this training program, and I can't stand those who are trying to pass it off as something wonderful. But they're still stuck in that they don't have any answer for the continuity problem. So Jesus is trying to tell them, hey, the Holy Spirit is the answer. But the righteous, Jesus didn't come for the righteous, as it were. One second, please. Okay, back. So what I would say to all the negative people is, yes, your dislike of it is very valid, and you're pointing out all this stuff, but it doesn't solve the problem at all. So we have to go beyond this negativity. It doesn't get us anywhere. And that's the hard part. That's the difficult part. That's what we're doing. That is what we're doing. So I'm not one of those Pollyannish people at all, not in the slightest bit. But the Holy Spirit, the way that it sees definition, we get to experience that. And we get to, that is, it's specifically designed to resolve our continuity issue, which I've gone in many, many, many videos spoken about this problem we have. But we're right now looking for to experience the solution to it all. So if you are a negative person, in other words, have negativity, tend to be very critical of the world and people and everything, I said, well, that's fine, that's good. But it doesn't go far enough. And so your task is to truly see the remedy of it. You can't just get stuck in isn't, you know, ain't it awful mode at all. You cannot get stuck in that. Because really you can just stay there and stay there and it doesn't go anywhere. You just remain there theoretically, you know, on and on and on and on and on and on. There's no resolution to it. There's no solution to the continuity problem. The continuity problem is a gigantic problem. And we're absolutely terrified of it. And the ego gives the ego just complete leverage over us. Like putty in the ego's hands. And the ego is just a sum total of all defenses against this continuity issue, this terror that we have. Terror of disorientation. If we leap right back to reality, wake up. Terror of disorientation, endless disorientation, we're terrified of it. So we just get led around easily by these defenses. And the defenses say, well, you don't like existence? Well, then criticize it. And so we think, oh, okay, that's the answer. No, it's not the answer, because it doesn't solve the continuity problem. We have to wake up. We have to quit this training program. We have to quit it. We have to exchange it for the Holy Spirit's training program. That's the only way we awaken to reality, get back to awareness of reality. It's the only way. So it's not the ego. When the ego says just be critical of it, that's not enough. That is not enough. That's not even it at all. But we're certainly not called toward any sort of boosterism of existence. No way. That's the Antichrist way. That's the ego. The ego's plan is to, again, avoid the continuity problem by making existence our home, our new home. And so it wants everybody to work on that project of making this our new home. So it makes all these promises to everybody. And it's conflicting promises. The ego tells one group this, another group this, another group this, and they all eventually come into conflict. And they say, hey, wait a minute, you know, I was told this. And the ego doesn't care. It's a defense system. Whatever it takes to keep us, to tamp down the fear of this continuity, this terror of continuity that we have, that we're going to end up in complete disorientation forever if we drop this training program of trying to learn how to die, impermanence. So there are lots of people in the world now, you know, and 7 billion, and they are leveraged and directed by the ego because of this continuity problem. They have this terror of it, and the ego just tells them what to do, and they just follow along, and the ego says, look, if it makes you feel better, just believe that God is telling you to do this. And they say, okay. Ego can say anything at all, and people will agree and say, okay, whatever it takes, boss. I just don't want to be disoriented forever, all right? But if you're aware of the Holy Spirit, then you get a little bit of courage, and you start speaking out against the ego, and you start saying, telling the truth, sharing the truth with people, with everyone. Everyone has one problem, just one problem, period. Anybody says they have some other problem, that's the ego talking, all right? Whatever it is in the world, the people are protesting, you know, the people are shouting and saying, I don't like this, I'm sick, that's the ego. The fact is, we have just one problem, nothing else, and that's the continuity problem. Again, without that continuity problem, without that fear of disorientation, okay, without that fear, we would instantly drop the flesh, drop impermanence, drop this training program, drop this dream, drop this hypothetical scenario, instantly drop it, vanish instantly, and we would never, ever even remember the slightest trace of it, period. That's it. Everyone would. So where would all the problems of existence be then? Nowhere. Nowhere. So we don't have any other problems. We have one problem. So when you watch the news and listen to what's going on in the world, and you hear people, ain't it awful, this or this or this, and complaining, maybe that's a little different than negativity. People are negative, say this is all, this world is just terrible, it's corrupt, it's awful. Whereas people are complaining and they say, you know, this world could be great if we just get rid of this problem. This world, I'm so disappointed in the world, how come we can't all live in tolerance and peace, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. One second here. From the standpoint of truth and the Holy Spirit and facts, that is completely missing the mark. It's an egoic defense. The ego doesn't want you to see that the continuity problem is the only problem. It will do anything to prevent you from seeing that. So that's why it's so difficult to see it. I mean, I finally have been able to reel it in, as it were, and see it, and see what's on the end of the line. Look at that fish on the end of the line. Oh, it's a continuity problem. Oh, okay, finally. But the ego is kind of desperate, you know, desperately trying to say, no, there's some here, it's this, it's over there, it's over there, it's over there. And so you have to keep struggling with this. And every morning, get up in the morning, and there's all these dreams and problems. You say, whoa, wait a minute, I only have one problem. All this stuff is bogus, totally bogus. And yet, I don't hear anybody talking about this in the world. That's testimony to our dreadful fear, you know, and the leverage that gives the ego over us. Everybody's seeking to solve some problem in the world, except the continuity problem, you know. Right the wrongs of the world, except don't touch the continuity problem. You know, stay away from it. It's radioactive. And no, it's not. It's not at all. It's actually, you find a great sense of relief in saying, ah, I see finally what the problem has been. And you keep reeling that fish in. So until we do this, we just are foolish. We're struggling in vain. And the world will become very arrogant. Very arrogant. And again, the most arrogant are those who claim peace, and claim somehow they found happiness in this world, etc. Okay, it's a totally different thing to find happiness with the ego's training program than to perceive the Holy Spirit's perception of definition, to experience that, get a claim of the Holy Spirit, and experience how the Holy Spirit defines everything. Totally different, totally different. Completely different. One is repentance and bliss. The other is arrogance and a feigned comfort, so to speak. It's already Thursday. Oh my gosh. Yeah, good. So existence works on arrogance. We are, you know, totally arrogant to think that we can change reality, that we can change what we are. That's pure arrogance. And those who recognize they're arrogant and admit it, say, yeah, those are the ones who are repenting. Those who pretend that they're innocent and pure and sweetly passive and nice and kind and compassionate and caring and all, you know, all that stuff. Without repentance, without admitting their extreme arrogance, those are the ones who are most arrogant, and they actually have leverage over others who are desperately trying to learn how to be more arrogant, how to be happy with this training program. They look to those and say, oh, here's a way, I will listen and take their advice instead of the Holy Spirit's advice in how to, those are idols. This world is idolatrous, actually. We follow idols in this world, okay? We follow idols. Those who are most arrogant tend to attract us, and we think, wow, if I could just learn how to do that, I can avoid the continuity problem, because I'll be happy with this place of impermanence. I'll be happy with this place. I can learn to be happy. Look at this idol, so beautiful, so kind, so sweet. I can learn to be happy like that. They're showing me how to be happy with existence, with this training program of death. And then, I think I can avoid the continuity problem. And then so you feel a little relief from that. That is Antichrist. That is the way of the ego, the Antichrist. The way that does not solve the continuity problem. It avoids it temporarily. Temporarily, it pushes it off a little bit, saying, I can outlast you, continuity problem. I don't need to actually resolve this. I can just be happy with existence. You know, I can just be happy as a person here in the realm of death and impermanence and instability and constant change. So we have a great tendency toward idolatry, extreme tendency, as a matter of fact. And our relationships are idolatrous too. Very much so, very much so. Human relationships are idolatrous. Now more than ever, and we look to one who seems to be better than us, and we make an eye, and they play the role of the idol, and then they control us and tell us, look, if you want to be like me, have my status and happiness, you have to work on the world and make it a better place. We're all told that we're supposed to make this world a better place. Okay, that is the Antichrist teaching, period. And most people see it the opposite way. They think that must be what Christ taught. No, it's not. It's the opposite. It's the opposite. We are supposed to get acquainted with the Holy Spirit and accept the Holy Spirit's invitation to perceive the world as it perceives the world. Perceive definition as it perceives definition. And that we will resolve the massive, gigantic problem we have, the continuity problem. And I've explained exactly how it resolves it, but we need to go beyond explanation to actually doing it. So I'm not going to go into a long explanation of how it works. It does. It will work for us because God created the Holy Spirit. It's precisely for that purpose. And of course, since we believe we can change what God created, we don't trust the Holy Spirit. We say, well, it must have been changed, or we'll be able to change it, you know, something like that. So the world is hell-bent on avoiding the Holy Spirit, avoiding the continuity problem, seeking idols to follow. To model themselves after and say, I want to be like this. I don't want to acknowledge the Holy Spirit. I can do it. I can avoid that by being happy here, etc. You can never be happy with this training program. It's impossible. Impossible. But the Holy Spirit can. You see, it's different. So we can take the Holy Spirit's perception for our own. It's a gift. It's a gift. We're saved by the grace of God, a gift of God, not by our works. Not by our works. And this message has to permeate us, and we have to say, wow, you rarely will hear this type of talk in the world. It used to be there were some more that would speak out, but these days, the age of idolatry is the age that we're in right now. It's the Kali Yuga, the age of idolatry, and we live in a very evil and adulterous generation as what scripture puts it that way. I would say extremely idolatrous generation. Maniacs, fanatics, people are fanatically idolatrous, and they simply are desperate again to, they think that they can avoid the continuity issue forever if they just gain complete control of everything. So here we are, saying thanks but no thanks to idolatry. Thanks but no thanks. Knowing that it doesn't help at all. Doesn't help us at all. It seems to buy us time. What we're doing is just buying time. Buying time, buying time, buying time, buying more time. And hoping that this continuity problem will go away. The more time we buy, the worse it gets. But it doesn't get worse for the Holy Spirit. It gets worse for us, but not the Holy Spirit. So the remedy remains perfectly effective. But our resistance to it, you know, tends to grow. And grow and grow. And so we keep pursuing idolatry. Very bad. And again, the ego has this leverage over us, so it keeps pushing us that way and saying, look at this one. Look how wonderful they are. You should serve them. Serve the idol. The idol will tell you what to do. And what does the idol tell you to do? Oh, go out there and work in the world. Work in the vineyards of the world. Build up this place. Make it better. Make it more beautiful. Make it more luxurious. Make it more comfortable. Get rid of the irritations. You know. And so basically, you have the princess complex telling everybody what to do. You know, the princess says, oh, there's a little too much dust here. Oh, I'm a little bit uncomfortable here. Make it better. Smooth it out. You know, come on, come on, come on. So it's the princess culture we live in, idolatrous princess culture. to this princess, the goddess I call the princess, is another term you can use, of saying you can be totally so happy here, so content here, so contented if you just slave away, slave away, slave away, and make the world a better place. Well, I wonder if the ocean thinks that humanity has made the world a better place. Has humanity improved the quality of the ocean? The ocean? Has it improved the quality of the air? Has it improved the quality of the forests? Has it improved the quality of the ecosystems of the planet? Have we really improved it, or have we made it worse? Clearly, we've made it a lot worse. And yet, all the while, we're thinking, oh, we've made the world such a wonderful place. Well, I don't know. Not for the world. The fact is, we cannot solve the continuity problem that way, as the squirrel continues to bombard this area with objects from space as I'm talking here. Now, there has been a basic understanding of this throughout the ages, how bad idolatry really is, and how dangerous it is. And this basic understanding gets passed down in various ways. And this basic understanding is under unprecedented assault in the world by idolaters who think, in their extreme arrogance, the princess is the apex of arrogance, and people think that this is the princess is just a nice way for the ego to market its defenses. It markets its defenses. Here's an effective way to market it, and so we follow this arrogant path, thinking that we have the answer, and that is just to avoid the continuity problem, make this world our home, and never have to go back to reality. Don't have to wake up. In other words, make the dream. Make ourselves so content with the dream, we never even want to wake up from it. Whereas the Holy Spirit makes the dream so incredibly lovely that it reminds us of reality so much that we say, "Hey, I'm no longer worried about dropping all these definitions, because of this incredible oneness, loveliness, blanket loveliness." Reminds me so much of reality, there's no continuity problem anymore. Okay, but we cannot do that. We cannot do that, make the world that lovely. It's impossible. Because the very means of perception we're using is not lovely at all. So if we can hold these lovely flowers in front of our eyes, but meanwhile the means of perception is not lovely at all. It's all threatened. It's all vulnerable. It's all subject. I mean, this whole planet's subject to space rocks, etc., cosmic catastrophes. How is that lovely? Where the means of perception is subject to death itself. So how can we really see, is death lovely? No, it's not lovely. So the Holy Spirit's means of perception is not subject to death, not subject to decay. It itself is lovely. Okay. So we need the Holy Spirit. Absolutely need the Holy Spirit. And so the central teachings of the planet have to be aligned with that we need the Holy Spirit, period. We need its perception. We need to see through its lens. It's like the Holy Spirit is like some super video camera, okay? Super video camera. I can do a lot of wonderful stuff with this camera. But the Holy Spirit's video camera, when you look through, you know, when you see the viewfinder of the Holy Spirit's, wow, you know, it's like, my gosh, it gives you a new viewfinder. Like, it's like you have this camera, a new camera with a new viewfinder, and it's alive, it's alive, you know. It's just like a new life, a new perception. Of course, what do we call life? Your perception. So a new life is new perception. Being born again means having a new perception. Jesus said, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven unless you're born again, meaning you have to have a new perception, a new video camera. Okay. I've had many video cameras, but I'm waiting for the ultimate one. I'm still trying to get that ultimate one, turn that one on, and look through that, see what I see in that camera. Now, visual arts can be used in several different ways. The ego can use them saying, hey, look how wonderful what we can do with our visual, you know, our cameras, our video cameras, etc. Or you can use it, the Holy Spirit can say, expand your experience of beauty and being able to see things in different ways through these cameras, and video cameras. So that gets you a little bit, you know, moves you towards looking at the ultimate video camera, which is the Holy Spirit's perception. So the Holy Spirit will just hand you like a video camera. So here you go, here's your new camera. Enjoy. And then you see the world through that lens. Seeing that world, the Holy Spirit has a lens for us, as it were. A miraculous lens, that we look through that lens and everything is transformed. The world is completely transformed. Now, which is right? Sensory perception or Holy Spirit's perception? Neither. The answer is neither. Right is not an issue with illusions. The question is, which is effective in solving the continuity problem? That's the only question. And it's the Holy Spirit's lens that is effective in solving the continuity problem. There is no right definition of definitions. Definitions of themselves are a lie. So is there a right lie? Is there a true lie? There is not. There is not. So it's up to you. You can choose the Holy Spirit's lens or the body's lens to look through. It's up to us. Neither one is right. Neither one is right, neither one is wrong. But the Holy Spirit's lens solves the continuity problem for us so that we can set down all lenses, all definitions. And this is just a simple gospel. This is just a simple gospel. And so many are missing the mark in this world. And it's obvious. Because why they miss the mark? Fear of the continuity problem is why they miss the mark. They're not able to get to this. They're too scared. Too scared. They think, it's too kitten. I don't want to get too close to the resolution of this situation. It's too dangerous. I fear disorientation, so I'm going to accept the ego's advice and parlay in some other bit of information into this perspective that is off the mark. It's off the mark. So just switch lenses. Just switch lenses. I believe that those who do work with the visual arts do have an opportunity, because they're stretching their perceptual boundaries all the time. I know I have been doing that for a long time, and you're used to seeing something quite different than what the body is used to seeing it through the lens, through various lenses and exposures and focuses and zooms and depth of field, you know, all this color, saturation, contrast, everything, playing with it, changing how everything looks. And that's beneficial, but one has to then, you know, get the clarity, take the next step, and understand the context of it all, and then ultimately accept the Holy Spirit's lens and look through that. A lens that can't be shattered, can't be harmed, can't be stolen, can't be lost, can't be changed. See, that's the lens. That's the lens you want to look through, because it shows you it's stable. The lens itself is stable. Isn't that what you really want? The lens is stable. The lens shows you, everything it shows you is incredibly beautiful, and the lens is stable. That's when the relief comes in. If you have an unstable lens and you're seeing something beautiful, you don't have the relief. You say, my God, I'm going to lose this beauty. But if the lens itself is stable, you will say, I have no worries anymore. I'm come what may, it's just, I have no worries. So this is the message that is seeping into the world, but it's barely seeping into the world. As I've said, the world's gone cuckoo. It's the world is a big cuckoo clock right now, and it's not a pretty sight at all. It is not a pretty sight what's going on. And again, criticizing it doesn't solve the problem. So we have to, again, turn our attention to the lens of the Holy Spirit and say, Holy Spirit, I accept your invitation to I accept your lens. I'm going to look at the world through your lens that you have for me. You have this wonderful lens, this wonderful camera lens for me. And I'm willing to see the world through that lens. Just keep on going in that direction. I have this very strong conviction that that is the right direction to go in. We must have our perception healed. We must have the continuity problem solved. We must have this new lens. It's not enough to go to a beautiful place if you're viewing it through the lens of human flesh. It's not good enough at all. Not at all. So I'm continuing to press forward in this direction. Have not yet seen through that lens, other than a glimpse or two. Again, it's the stability of the lens that's the key issue. All right? That one thought will change your whole life. It's the stability of the lens that's the issue. That's the real beauty, isn't it? See, we don't... It's a subtle thing, because what the Holy Spirit will show us is all this incredible beauty, but gradually we will realize that the lens is totally stable. And then we'll say, oh my gosh, that's just like reality. Reality's totally stable. And then we'll be able to set it all down without a problem. But first, we get the vision of this tremendous, flawless, seamless beauty, etc. And gradually, it seeps into us, this feeling that the lens is flawless, the lens is perfect, the lens is completely stable. But it sort of peripherally seeps into us, not directly. We're not confronted directly with that issue, but that's an issue that we will become aware of gradually. And then the appreciation grows and grows and grows and grows and grows. Gratitude grows and grows and grows. Subtly, beautifully, etc. All right, well, the ego wants me to go to all these nice places and keep using the lens of flesh to view these beautiful places. And I say, oh, I've been there and done that, ego, you know, that doesn't work. They're still trying to get me to do that. But no matter how beautiful whatever it is you're viewing is, and I can take some very beautiful imagery I have in my life. I've through the lens, I've had cameras up to my eye most of my life, and through the lens, I have seen incredible stuff. It just where my mouth is just slack-jawed in amazement of just how stunning what I'm seeing is. Through tremendous, you know, zoom, and vibrant color, and compressing space, and just like, whoa. But the lens is not stable. The camera is not stable. It breaks. All my cameras are broken. Now I have this real cheap little one. Where I used to have ones that were expensive. And they all broke, and they're all not useful anymore. And that's not good. And I always felt very vulnerable, like, oh my God, what if this camera breaks, or I get, you know, get grit in it or something, or it gets dropped, or it's something, you know, it's just fragile. It's fragile. There's always a sense of the fragility of the perceptual apparatus, no matter what. So the lens, this camera and the lens of the Holy Spirit is not fragile. It's totally stable, totally invulnerable. And that's just like, oh, wow. That seems to be what I want. And those who have this say that the perceptual abilities are just amazing. Ability to see at a distance. You can see any 1,000 miles away, you can see it just like as if it were right here. It's a whole different perceptual apparatus, as it were, lens, a whole different lens. Completely stable, completely reliable. And this perception that of human beings is actually the subtle way that we're trying to teach ourselves how to die. So remember that when you're looking at the news and all this ain't it awful outrage, all the outrage in the world, etc., and the terrible stuff that the news is constantly pumping out, like sewage, spiritual sewage, like an IV drip into us to try and dispirit us, to dumb us down into a low info status. Just remember, just keep this in mind. Say, wait a minute, I need the lens of the Holy Spirit. That's the key. Let me see the world through the lens of the Holy Spirit. You know, whatever it is going on, I'm going to choose to see it through the lens of the Holy Spirit, and then I will be seeing it through a lens that is not vulnerable. That is the key, okay? A lens that is stable, a stable lens. So it doesn't matter what's taking place. Let me get a stable lens, and then I'll evaluate it from that perspective. Otherwise, I'm holding back evaluation because I'm contaminating my evaluation through the fact that my perceptual apparatus is completely vulnerable and is decaying and falling apart. I notice I'm going to lose it. That colors my interpretation of what I'm seeing, etc. Totally. And nobody can escape that. That like overlays it. It like contaminates everything. So we don't really know how things look. We don't really know what's going on. We don't really know anything at all. As it is, because our perceptual mechanism is flawed and faulty. So don't try to reach any particular conclusions about whatever there. Just say, you know what, I know my means of perception is faulty. My means of perception is faulty. Therefore, let me choose a new means of perception that isn't faulty. And then we'll go from there. Just, it's a no-brainer. It's a no-brainer. Just remember that. And then when you hear this again in another video, which I'm sure you will, you'll say, oh my gosh, how could I have forgotten that? Unbelievable. I forgot it again. Of course, because the continuity fear of disorientation is so severe. The ego tells us, hey, you don't need to remember that. Pay attention to this, and you do, and then you forget it. So, we can do it. I don't know if we will or not. I really don't, but we can. We can. It's possible. But, you know, it's so hard to predict from what's going to happen in your life. So all you can do is to keep making as much progress as you can in the right direction. And eventually, but it would be really good if it was soon, but again, who knows the resistances, etc., that the reluctances that we have, they seem to be almost never ending. But I know I've certainly made progress, and today made a lot of progress. I know this idea of this lens, hold this lens, if you're holding a new lens in your hands, like solid gold, pure gold lens or something, and you say, oh, I can hold this up and I can look at the world through this lens. Just sort of imagine that that's possible, because it is. Now, I certainly believe that I will do this soon, but, you know, who's to say that, well, you know, doing it is believing it, you know. It's a question of actually doing it, and how do you do it, is the question. You want to do it, but how do you actually do it? How do you get this lens and actually look through it? Well, you keep trying, and you fail, and then you say, well, I got to do better, and then you fail, and you say, I have to do better, you fail, have to do better, and you just keep trying every day. Say, well, I didn't do good enough today. So I didn't do it today. It means I failed. Why did I fail? Why did I not do this? And just keep on working at it and trying to do it. And someone who's actually looking through this lens, this big golden lens, pure gold, you're looking through it, you'll know that they're looking through this lens, because they'll have a different They'll be in a different space, as it were. They'll have a different vibe, different presence. This golden lens, the lens of the Holy Spirit, they're looking at you through that. So they're seeing you very differently than if they were looking just with, you know, sensory perception here. Very differently. And to them, you would look incredibly beautiful. And I'm told you, the lens does not even see bodies. It transforms bodies into this incredible filigree light or something. You know, you see bodies are gone and spirit seems to be there. This wonderful light display of beautiful light or something. That's what I've heard. You don't even see bodies at all. Seeing bodies is idolatry, as a matter of fact. Seeing bodies is idolatry. Absolutely it is. Sheer arrogance. So let us again imagine a big lens made out of pure gold, but light. You can hold it, easy to hold. And we just hold this up to our perception, as it were. And we perceive through this lens everywhere we turn. Everywhere we turn, we put these golden lenses in our glasses. Everywhere we turn, you know, it's like, you see that. We can all have these, instead of Google glasses or Google, whatever these new glasses are that they're testing out now, we can have clarity glasses. And these clarity glasses have these special Holy Spirit lenses in them. And we're looking at the world, everything we see is just like incredibly beautiful. That's what we can do. That is what we can do. This is a focus we need to have. And so I'm just doing everything I can to bring this to everyone's attention, and feeling a lot of fatigue and pressure and wow, my system is really getting hit hard. But still have to persevere here. And certainly we will do exactly that. Welcome to August. And here in August, we have a new focus, don't we? We've gotten to this point of something really practical that we can think of. Look, hold this lens up, and look through these glasses with this pure, totally stable lenses, and look at the world that way. And then report back and say, what are you seeing now? What are you seeing now? Don't rely on the body senses. That's what Jesus tells us. Don't rely on the body senses. They're lying. They're lying to you. The body senses are lying, period. But again, as I stressed earlier, there is no right or wrong. It's practicality. What solves the continuity problem? What solves the continuity problem is the issue. You know, not that the body senses are wrong and the Holy Spirit's perception is right. All perceptions of illusions are mistaken perceptions, are nothing. Nothing really at all. But which solves the continuity problem is the real issue. So look at it that way. Don't get in a judgmental mindset. That can really cause you problems. Don't get in a judgmental mindset. Get in a pragmatic mindset. Simply pragmatic, that is all. We're going towards pragmatism. Okay. Towards anything else. We're going towards pragmatism, not towards judgmentalism. Pragmatism. It's just being very pragmatic. And the world is getting away from pragmatism, and they're getting very judgmental. So we are staying with pragmatic, what works. What works, okay? All perception is a lie, but the Holy Spirit's perception solves the continuity problem for us, and that's all that matters, period. That's all that matters, because that's the only problem we have. All right. Still managing here to bring this gospel to the world somehow, but I've been told that some videos are not working so great, and I've had problems uploading my videos, that some upload, others will refuse to upload and stuff. It's like, you know, there's some interesting glitches taking place out there. But again, no worries, no judgment. Be pragmatic. You have that lens. The Holy Spirit will give it to you. See through that lens, and then see. Report back and say, how do I feel now? How do I feel now? That's the key. That's the key. Go beyond complaint to the new vision. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.